Okay. Hello everyone, Croeso, welcome and welcome back to Value in Health Wales. My name's Sally Lewis, I'm the National Clinical Lead for Value-Based Healthcare in Wales, and it's my pleasure to introduce you today to a session on learning and education in Wales. I'd like to introduce my colleagues, Professor Hamish Laing, who is Professor of Enhanced Innovation at and Engagement at Swansea University Business School, and Rebecca Richards, who is the Director of the NHS Wales Finance Academy. Next slide. Value-based healthcare has its origins in the grassroots in NHS Wales, and the origin of education for Value-based Healthcare Wales is really in terms of a cultural shift, and that's what I'm going to talk about in the next few slides before introducing Hamish and Rebecca, who will describe to you some of the more formal education programmes that are now being delivered and planned across Wales. Next slide. So in order to deliver value-based healthcare, a number of key ingredients are necessary. And first of all, we need to effect the cultural shift around language and behaviour towards value-based decision making in the system. And there's key infrastructure to build as well, embedding outcomes, measurement and costing, and an attention to health informatics development across the whole system to enable that. Next slide, please. But without that shift in a culture towards value-based healthcare thinking, we can't achieve any of this. And so the first thing to do is to really start to embed value-based healthcare thinking and language in the health boards. This quote from Michael Porter and Elizabeth Tisberg's book, Redefining Healthcare, states that each department or physician practice takes a piecemeal view of care. This fractured system obscures information on overall results and prices of caring for a patient. And I think there's a lot of truth in that statement, that we all work very hard within our own little bits of the system, but it can often be difficult for us to see the whole system and to see things from the patient's perspective as they journey through that system. And we know that for patients it can feel very fragmented at times, and we know that we don't always manage to allocate resources therefore for where we can have the greatest impact for patients. Now, Porter and Tisberg described integrated practice units as a solution to that. And of course, in Wales, we feel that we have the ideal system with our integrated health boards to create that whole system view and culture. Next slide. So creating an organisational structure that's consistent with value encourages us to fully utilise the MDT. And here I'm really talking about professionals from financial managers and operational managers, clinicians, informaticians and patients working together to really see what we need to do within the system to improve outcomes with the resources that we have. We need to align digital strategy with clinical strategy to deliver value-based healthcare. And we need to avoid bias towards what we've always done. It's very difficult to change and much easier to stay the way we are, even when staying where we are is riskier. So we need to be brave and move towards value-based decision making. Next slide. So changing the mindset and creating a culture focused on value really means creating a common language centered around outcomes and outcomes that matter to patients. So that includes the traditional sorts of information that we would have collected in a clinical audit, which includes case mix variables and collecting information about patient demographics and their comorbidities, their clinical outcomes and treatment variables. But that's not far enough, is it? We need to also collect and embed patient-reported outcomes and patient-relevant outcomes and experience measures and even family-reported outcome measures into our healthcare system so that we can understand the outcomes we're achieving with the healthcare we're delivering, quality of life and symptom burden for our patients. And that way we can understand how to direct resource towards where it has the greatest impact for patients. So supporting clinical audit as part of that is absolutely critical and a key educational point. Next slide, please. So everything that has been developed as part of the National Value-Based Healthcare Programme is a result of that on the ground grassroots learning about what we need to do to change the system towards a value-based healthcare system. And there are six goals, as you see here. But the fourth goal around communication, education and engagement, and for which this week's activities plays a key role, is really, really important. So we need to embed a culture of value in NHS Wales that's supported by not just informal education and engagement mechanisms, but also now formal academic partnerships that can really bring some academic rigour to value-based healthcare learning in Wales. And on that note, I would like to hand you over to my esteemed colleague, Professor Hamish Lang, who's going to go into more detail about that. Thank you, Hamish.
Thank you very much, Sally, and a very warm welcome to everyone. And thank you for this opportunity to tell you a little bit about what's going on from a university perspective in education in value-based health and care. And we're very pleased to be partnering with the national programme from Swansea University. Next slide, please. So globally, there are a small number of universities engaged in providing education in value-based healthcare. And that is really about short course or executive education, as some people would call it. And of course, Harvard Business School started it and continued to run their programme from the States. And Elizabeth Tisberg, who was in Harvard and is now at Dell Medical School in Texas, at Austin, Texas, also has a program there. There is also an opportunity to do a module of the Masters in Industrial Drug Development at the University of Copenhagen. You can do that as a freestanding executive education module. And finally, it's not really a university, but the Value-Based Healthcare Centre in Europe is an affiliate of Harvard Business School, and they deliver some programmes there, including their yellow and green belt programmes. And I'm really delighted to be able to say that now Swansea University has joined the list of academic institutions around the world delivering short course education. And I'm going to tell you just a little bit about that in a second. So if I could have my next slide, please. So we have recently started an executive education programme in value-based health and care. And in fact, we're just in the middle, or just right at the very end of our first programme, which was initially going to be face-to-face, but for obvious reasons, it's been transferred into a virtual form. And in fact, we have the seventh of the seven modules on Monday, and that will be the conclusion of that programme. And that has been delivered for 48 very senior leaders from the global pharmaceutical industry, from 28 different countries, including some board level members, so some very senior learners indeed. And we've been supported in doing that through a strategic partnership that the university has entered into with Sprink, the company that Tom Kelly, who some of you will know, has established. And as you can see on the right of the slide, the faculty for the course we've been running for Pfizer has many people you will recognise from across NHS Wales, to whom we're very grateful, but also international colleagues too. And it's been a fantastic faculty. So we've had Thomas Alvin from EFPIA, the European Federation of Pharmaceutical Industries and Associations, Ari Franks, an obstetrician who leads the government's programme in Holland, Amy Compton-Phillips, Chief Medical Officer for Providence, which is a very large health provider in the west coast of the States, I think 51 hospitals, $30 billion turnover. John Doyle, a Senior Vice President of Pfizer from their global headquarters in New York. Mike Roby, who led a lot of the work at Medtronic, which many of us are familiar with, but is now doing the same in Becton Dickinson, Colette Goldrick from the ABPI, and Roger Phillips, who was a senior executive with Nutritia, a Swiss company, also with an interest in value-based healthcare. So really, really fantastic to see people coming together, all looking for an opportunity to teach about value-based healthcare, and we're delighted to have had their help. In addition, we were also very pleased to win a tender that Halvar let, again in partnership with Tom Kelly and Sprink, to co-create two programs for their staff. And we've completed the co-creation. In fact, we're really excited. We're going to start delivering the first of those programs. We're going to do it twice. We're going to deliver the first starting next month. And we hope to get at least 50 of their staff through that program. And the faculty for that is drawn also from Wales and the university, but importantly also from Halvar, because we're very keen to build capacity in the system in Wales to deliver education. Next slide, please. So the shape of the programme we're delivering at the moment, which would be very similar to the one we're going to deliver in future, and I'll come to that, has seven modules. This is the virtual form. An introduction to value-based healthcare with the perspective of patients playing into it, and we have some really excellent patients who are helping us with that, and setting learning goals for the learners. The second module is around the principles of value-based healthcare, about measuring outcomes and using outcomes, and that's a case-based module, drawing on examples from around the world and how other people have put value-based healthcare into practice. The third is about translating it into different systems, and that's where our international faculty contributed so much, talking about how they were using value-based healthcare in different health systems around the world and what we could learn from that. The fourth, with a focus on the life science industry and the importance of outcome-based agreements and the role the life science industry can play in delivering value throughout the whole pathway of patients. The fifth was a simulated negotiation, and we're very grateful to colleagues from procurement in NHS Shared Services, who, as it were on the other side, really trying to put into practice how would they engage with a health system such as NHS Wales to deliver value, not just with their medicine or their device, but actually throughout the whole pathway in prevention, in early intervention, in information and education, health literacy, right through to an outcome-based agreement, perhaps for the product as well. And then finally, we had a global perspective on how this was happening around the world in the life science sector. And finally, the final session on Monday will be about reflections, the key learning, and setting their objectives for the future. So that's what we've been doing, we're doing now, and we're going to offer a very similar course for that in March, but open not just to life science colleagues, but we're really keen to attract colleagues from the health systems and social care, because we think the real value in this is to have all three sectors in the same room, as it were, learning together, sharing perspectives, understanding each other's challenges and their viewpoints, so that we can build partnerships between health and social care, between social care and third sector, between health and life science, really to get the whole system working in a value-based healthcare way. Next slide, please. So that's, if you like, the non-degree level education. So what's happening globally around degrees in value-based healthcare? And the answer is vanishingly little. So, which is why, next slide, we were really excited when we read in A Healthier Wales of the proposal around intensive learning academies. And this is a very long sentence from it, so if I just pick up a few key points. The intensive learning academies are intended about professional capability. They're creating hubs for skills and expertise, for translating research into outcomes, and that graduates of the academies would be senior leaders in the health and social care system. And they would support the delivery of policy and change and be advocates of change. Next slide, please. So we were very pleased when Welsh Government put out a call at Christmas for the business schools in Wales to lead proposals around intensive learning academies. And we submitted, on behalf of Swansea University, we submitted a proposal for a value-based health and care academy. We've been through all the process of that, the business case is in, we've had the scrutiny. It's been very well received by Welsh Government, and we're just waiting now on a decision from the Minister, which we hope will come soon. And I thought I would share with you what we hope to do if the Welsh Government are supportive of our proposal. Next slide, please. So the academies, our academy would be built on three pillars. And I'm going to talk mostly about the education pillar for obvious reasons today, but importantly, that we shouldn't lose sight of the research pillar. It's really important that the delivery, this is an evolving paradigm. We're all learning how to do value-based healthcare. And it is really important that we are promoting research to learn more about it, and also using that research to make sure the teaching is right at the leading edge of knowledge. So we will have a research pillar and a consultancy pillar to help systems to move their businesses or their health systems towards a value-based health and care approach. And that also supports the sustainability of the academy. And I'm going to talk more about education now. Next slide, please. So we will offer, if we're asked to do so by government, the existing executive education programme, so short course format programmes. They'll either be online in the current circumstances, or we hope they will be blended, a combination of online learning, but also some on-campus learning, because we want to get people together, talking over coffee, sharing each other's learning and perspectives. It will be case-based, and we're very keen to develop for teaching more cases from Wales, using some of the excellent examples in Wales, but also globally. This is a globally, an international looking programme, but with a real heart of Wales at its heart. Mixed participation, as I say, including colleagues from social care. And we've had some fantastic conversations with colleagues in social care. And although they don't use the language of value-based health and care, they do talk a lot about person-centred care and outcomes-focused care. It's the same principle, and we would love to see that common language helping to join health and social care colleagues together with a common objective for their clients or patients. And we will be looking to get these courses accredited initially by the Faculty of Medical Leadership and Management, but other organisations in due course. In addition, we'll be wanting to provide an e-bulletin to keep sharing news and knowledge as it comes through from different examples. Providing content updates for alumni of the programme through a digital platform, and also following up with people who've done the programme to see how they're getting on with delivering their personal goals. Providing mentorship, if they wish, from our faculty or previous alumni. And then working with the national programme, colleagues in Social Care Wales and the Finance Academy, to take what already exists as online material and apply some kind of academic rigour to that, and some pedagogical approaches to make sure that it's really delivering well for people, for the majority of staff. So our programmes will be focused at senior people, but for the majority of staff, to provide, if you like, a kind of bronze level learning for them too. And we're talking to HEIW about that as well. Next slide, please. But in terms of credit bearing, so that's degree level qualifications, we have developed a brand new MSc in Advanced Health and Care Management with a value-based health and care pathway within it, which would be can be sat full or part-time. It's new, it's case-based, it's intended to have both international and local faculty and growing local talent. And it will contain a work-based project, and we think this is really important for learners to be able to apply their learning back in their workplace, but also to give back to the employer who has released their employee, to give them something back for doing so. Thrilled that we've managed to navigate a new degree through the university in about 2 months. It normally takes about 2 years, people tell me, and it's ready to go for 2021. And just one bit of feedback we had from the external assessor, an experienced academic, and he said that he particularly commended us for the idea of having health, social care and life science colleagues, as it were, in the same classroom, which he said in his extensive experience of such programmes was unique and very important. We will also offer a postgraduate diploma option for people who don't want to do a full MSc. So that'll be, if you like, two thirds of the MSc, but it will be the thirds that include the value-based specialist pathway modules and the work-based project, because as I say, we think the project's really important. Next slide, thank you. So this is a slightly complicated slide that shows the structure of the degree for people interested, but the first semester will be two general management modules drawn, in fact, from the brand new MBA that the university is establishing. To give a base for people who are aspiring leaders and leaders in leadership and management principles. Then in this second semester, the specialist pathway, I'll explain the peach boxes in a moment, but you'll see that the blue boxes of varying shades of blue are, the first is a module that sets value-based healthcare in the setting of prudent healthcare and the other global equivalents, but also social care policy in Wales and the other global equivalent to that too. So understanding how they relate. And then a module focused on developing value-based healthcare strategy and another on implementation. Throughout that second semester will be some modules about research in a healthcare context to help prepare people for the project that they do in semester three. And they'll write up a project report for that, and that will complete the degree. Next click, I think. And you'll see this module here is actually a common module. The peach boxes are, the university has also put forward a proposal for a separate intensive learning academy with colleagues in Cardiff and the Bevan Commission and the Life Science Hub around innovation and transformation. And we will share elements of this new degree, including that common module. And then the peach boxes are the pathway that relates to innovation and transformation for people doing that degree. Next slide. So for those people who don't want to do a full MSc but would like to get a postgraduate diploma, then what they will do is join for semesters two and three. So they will do the value-based healthcare specialist module pathway and the research project in the workplace with the report that would follow that, and that would give them 120 credits and a postgraduate diploma. Next slide, thank you. But as if that wasn't enough, we were very keen to be driving up the amount of research in value-based health and care. It is a new field and people are learning all the time about many aspects of it, and we wanted to have a research degree that went alongside it. And we debated having a PhD, but actually we have opted for a doctorate in business administration. So that's a part taught, part research based degree. It will be run over 3 years of formal teaching, so two modules a year, each with a 6,000 word paper to write at the end of it. And then in years four and beyond, a research project and a thesis, which would be a little shorter than a full PhD thesis, but still quite considerable, sort of 60 to 80,000 words. And we're expecting people will take it, will take at least 1 year and possibly two to complete that work. And there's a viva at the end on the thesis. So that's, again, a unique thing that is going to be available in Wales, in Swansea, which you can't do anywhere else in value-based health and care. Next slide. So the business case we've submitted to Welsh Government includes the opportunity to provide fully funded places on these degrees for colleagues from health, social care and the third sector in Wales. If the case is supported, we'll be able to offer 10 places on the MSc or the PGDIP for each cohort, one fully funded doctorate in business administration for the duration of that, so one every year, for the 3 years of funding that Welsh Government are currently proposing, and five free places on the executive education courses, and we're planning to run those three times a year. So some fantastic opportunities for colleagues in the public sector in Wales to get what I hope you will agree will be great education without having the worry of finding the funding. And that's particularly true for the third sector and social care, who have even less access to funding than colleagues in health. The process we will adopt if we proceed with this is you'll have to meet, of course, the academic requirements first. So you'll get a place on one of these degrees, and then you will apply for one of the funded places. And we're going to try and allocate those in a way that is fair, but gives a reasonable distribution across the different sectors. So it doesn't all go to health or all go to social care, for example. And in the event that not all those funded places are taken up on a particular course, then they'll be carried forward. So there'll just be more places on a subsequent course. So we will be allocating all of those funded places for the during the 3 years. And then the rest of the students will be self-funding students or students whose organisations are funding them, or from industry as well. And with all of that, and the other elements of the academy, we would plan for it to be self-sustaining by the end of the third year. Next slide, please. So that brings me to the conclusion of our this talk. Just to say that if you would like, we have opened the course for March to expressions of interest and applications already. Details are on our website, which is swansea.ac.uk/SOM, that's the School of Management, /SOM, /VVHC. If you want to email us about it, there's an email address there on the slide. And if you're interested in the Doctorate in Business Administration, I would really encourage you to contact my colleague Simon Brooks, who's running that programme. His email is on the slide, s.b.brooks@swansea.ac.uk, and he can give you a bit more information and perhaps have a call with you to talk through what it would involve, because that's obviously quite a big commitment for a student, but we think would be very worthwhile indeed, and there's already been some interest, which is very exciting. So we're really pleased that Swansea is already amongst a very small number of very prestigious institutions to be offering executive education in value-based healthcare, and we would love to see you on those courses. We're even more excited about the opportunities that an academy would bring if the Minister is able to support it, particularly obviously the opportunity to offer some fully funded places to colleagues from Wales. But even without that, we think it'll be very good value. We hope you will, if you're interested in that, express interest through the website as well, and we'll be publishing more as soon as we hear from the Minister. So thank you very much. And my next slide, please. So with that, I'd like now, if I could, to hand over to my colleague Rebecca Richards, who I'm sure many of you will know, is Director of the NHS Wales Finance Academy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hamish. And just to say, it's an absolute pleasure to be here today. Can I have my first slide, please? You will have already heard from a number of finance people across Wales talking about the work that they're already doing in value, and a couple of superstars are appearing across the course of this week already. What I'm going to talk to you about is how the Finance Academy to date has structured its sort of education programme for value-based healthcare for the finance community. Before I get into that, I just introduce who we are. We are not a formal institution. We are the collaboration of every finance director across NHS Wales and their teams, who have the collective ambition to create a finance function that's best suited to Wales, but comparable to the best anyway, with the aim that we add value to the organisations we support and the populations we serve. Next slide. And I just wanted to put this one up, really, which is something I've learned since coming into this post. I'm not an OD specialist by any means, but something about the design of our programmes is around the practical application of the things that we learned. So a lot of our Finance Academy programmes, you will see there is an element for education and training, and I'm really excited to hear the work that Swansea University and Hamish are developing in this space. But we also know that we really learn about the application of this learning when we try to put it in practice and trying to create the environment for people to get the opportunity to practice and to learn from each other. So there's a lot of emphasis of peer-to-peer work and networking in across all of our programmes, and hopefully you'll see that as a feature of some of the work that we're doing in this space. Next slide, please. So from a Finance Academy perspective, it absolutely aligns to the national programme. We want to, for every member of staff, embed value-based healthcare as a standard best practice approach across NHS Wales. We want to foster partnerships across the professions, creating a common language and ambition for creating value. And we want to learn from national and international approaches through sharing and networking. Next slide, please. So in terms of how we are approaching this across the finance function across NHS Wales, as you can imagine, we're trying to make sure that we are properly skilled in many facets of finance, but we wanted to make sure that value-based healthcare was absolutely embedded in the learning and development across all staff across Wales. So we've developed a bit of a graduated learning model, which starts at the bottom, which is around everybody working in NHS Wales should have a basic understanding of what value-based healthcare is. I've been really excited to work with Sally in the national programme in developing an introduction webinar to value-based healthcare, which we were the guinea pigs for, which is fantastic, and is now up on our site for all finance staff to access and view. And then moving into practitioner level, so those people who are doing this on a day-to-day basis or should be doing this as part of their role, you will have heard yesterday the fantastic work that the finance delivery unit have been developing on a finance toolkit. And a bit of a plug to finance staff that may be watching, the finance webinar will take place on the 3rd of November for all finance staff across Wales to access. And I'm going to talk to you a bit about the clinical and financial development programme that we designed in this practitioner space. And then moving on to sort of national specialists who across Wales are the real experts in finance on value-based healthcare and who can we work with. And as Hamish has alluded to, a lot of the guys at the finance delivery unit are already operating in this space and helping with some of the more formal education programmes. And we'll continue to work with them in terms of how we develop our in-house development programmes going on forward. Next slide, please. So the clinical and financial development programme came about by thinking about what is our ambitions as a finance academy, how do we really foster some great relationships with the clinicians going forward, and how can we learn about value together? So the programme is that they would apply to our programme as a pair. We did have some people saying, can I apply on my own? And we said, no, you must come as a pair, one clinician, one finance, and you had to come with an idea of how you would like to apply value in practice. They were co-sponsored by the medical directors and the finance directors, so they had that very senior sponsorship to allow them to both apply and be supported across the programme. The programme lasted 9 months, so it was the odd day that we came together and brought them together with the expectation that they would go away and apply some of that learning in practice. Some of the features of the programme that we wanted to hit was that it would be accredited. So we were really pleased that the Faculty of Medical and Leadership Management accredited our programme so that it drew that appeal from some of the clinicians. There's a lot of time spent on improving the relationship between clinicians and finance. So we spent quite a bit of time talking about different perspectives and what value meant to us, even though we're working from different professions. That the whole programme was grounded in Welsh Government policy. Why is it important to Wales, and therefore why is it important to you working within NHS Wales? Understanding how decisions are made we thought was important for participants so that when they get that value improvement that they want to develop in their organisation, they know how to navigate the system, which is not always the best way, not always that clear to people. And obviously really important to us that it was a safe place and protected time to explore and put into practice some of the things that they learned. Next slide, please. So in terms of the contents of the programme, as I already said, there was a national strategic context. We had views from the board of what they would be looking for from a value-based perspective and also from a governance perspective. We talked about the theory and case study examples of how you would apply value-based approach in practice, drilling down then into operational tools and techniques that they could use to apply. And then at the end of the programme, they were asked to demonstrate how they'd apply this in practice in their organisation through a project. So there was a finale at the end where they did a poster exhibition to describe what they'd learned and how they'd applied it. Now, we knew when we designed this programme, Sally and I, that there was no way they were going to put an absolutely all singing, all dancing value-based approach in 9 months. That wasn't going to be the case. But we just wanted some symbols, I suppose, that they'd learned what we'd shown them, they'd had the opportunity to apply, and really, more importantly, how they were going to take that forward in their organisations from that point onwards. Next slide, please. So who applied? We were really delighted because they came from pretty much every part of Wales and from a whole spectrum of clinical areas. So we had staff from critical care, haematology, we had a GP cluster, foot and ankle services, people working in scheduled care, children's acute theatre, mental health, and people who wanted to apply it on a whole system basis. So a real blend and mix of people from all parts of Wales and all different specialties. And I think that was probably some of the joy that Sally and I observed, was the conversations that took place across different specialties, across different organisations, of their experience of putting this into practice in their organisations. The next slide is a video that, if it works, it might just give you a little flavour at what it was like to be on this programme.
As a child, you would wait and watch from far away, but you always knew that you'd be the one to work while they all play. And you'd lay awake at night and scheme of all the things that you would change, but it was just a dream. Your spirit never dies. Farewell, I've gone to take my throne above. But don't weep for me, 'cause this will be the labor of my love.
The music was a bit dramatic, wasn't it? But I just thought it'd be liven up the session a little bit, maybe from my perspective. Next slide, please. So we asked all the way through the programme, how was it for them? Was it hitting the markers in terms of the things that they needed to know, so that we could be pretty agile in its delivery and bringing in different people in as we needed to help them on their journey of exploring value? And at the end of the programme, as you would expect, we asked them for their feedback. This is not a formal evaluation, I must say, but we did ask them many questions about how the programme worked for them. This is just one slide which describes some of the comments, and I'm really pleased at the positive response that we received, which was that they felt more confident that they knew about value-based healthcare and how it applied to NHS Wales. They felt more equipped to apply a value-based approach in their service area, that they were, for many of them, applying it now in their organisation. And for us, what was an important marker was that they felt more confident that they could approach their counterpart, finance or clinician, on a value aspect than they had been at the start. Next slide, please. So it's been 10 months since the end of the programme. So it was an opportunity, I guess, for today is to catch up with them and say what happened next. And of course, apart from the obvious things that have happened in the meantime, they were able to describe back to me that for many of them, they were now collecting outcomes, although it still felt early days and early use in their organisations, they were able to apply that. Some of them had applied a time-driven activity-based approach and were looking at costing or had plans to. Some had developed some parkway redesign, some had developed local dashboards, and for a couple of them, they'd changed roles and therefore the things that they planned to do were no longer happening, but in changing their roles, they were able to take the learning with them. One of the clinicians told me that for the first time ever, they were able to develop a business case that was founded in value and successfully navigated through their organisation, and they felt the learning that they'd acquired through this programme was helpful to that. And a number of them have said, you know, on the road to COVID recovery, we absolutely need to be using a value-based approach. So it wasn't meant to be a resounding success in a series of projects that would be stunning in terms of value-based approach, but I'm really pleased that we've started people off on their learning approach and applying it in their organisation. And hopefully through the things that they're talking about in their organisation, spreading that word more widely. For the future, we had hoped that we'd relaunch this programme during this year, but of course, other events have taken over. We probably will look to launch this in the spring of next year, but based on the feedback from both clinicians and finance, they felt that to include some of the operational managers would be really helpful, that there was lots of opportunity for improvement, that would probably really work better if we're able to include those operational managers. So I'm really pleased that we've been able to speak to the CHOOs, the Chief Operating Officers, with a view to potentially making this more of a triumvirate programme that's clinicians, finance and operational staff, if we're able to relaunch it again next spring. Next slide. And that's it from me, really. I hope that's given you a flavour of the sorts of things that Sally and I dipped our toe in the water of trying some sort of development programme around value for clinicians and finance. And please do get in touch if any of that is of interest and you'd like to explore further. Thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca, and thank you, Hamish. Wow, what a comprehensive range of educational initiatives for Wales and for beyond as well, indeed. We've now got some time for questions. Rebecca, while you're still on the line, you mentioned the importance of experiential learning generally and in value-based healthcare. I agree with that statement, and I wonder if you could tease that point out a little bit further for us by perhaps describing some of the examples you witnessed during the clinical financial programme.
I'd probably draw on one where it was in Betsy. They were looking at foot and ankle services, and I think it's fair to say that both the clinician and the finance representative that attended probably had very little of knowledge of value when they came into the programme. They just knew they wanted to do some sort of improvement there. And what they were able to do is start to look at outcomes for patients, albeit on a really small scale. But even doing that piece of work, we're able to identify where there were opportunities for improvement, recognising that there was still a long way to go. So the fact that they were able to come on the programme, learn about the approaches, some of the techniques, go away, try them out, come back, talk about their experience, talk to some of the colleagues on the programme about what they'd done, test it out with others from not the same specialty, but that was the interesting thing about it. And then go away and try it again. And I think from the finance perspective, they were looking to develop a finance response to this. So they tried to apply a time-driven activity-based costing approach, a little slow perhaps in its implementation. But I think what it started is an ambition of the art of the possible. I think the sort of the light bulb moment went off when they thought, oh, we could really do something really interesting in this and it really could transform our services. So having the space, I suppose, to think about it, having the opportunity to go away, practice it, bring it back and talk about it, I feel as part of the programme has been really invaluable to them and really exciting for us to watch.
Thank you, Rebecca. And I think it'll be really interesting to see what happens when we add operational managers into the mix, because I'm sure that that will only improve the programme and enrich it further. Thank you very much. Hamish, can I turn to you now? I have a few questions for you, actually. The first one is a comment, first of all, fantastic educational opportunities, well done. Will staff working in the not-for-profit sector be eligible for sponsorship?
Thanks, Ali. That's a very good question. I'm going to slightly cop out of it and say that of course, the terms of the sponsorship will actually be set by Welsh Government, who are the sponsor, and we'll be working closely with them. But I very much hope, and it is our intention, that it would be third and voluntary sector, charitable sector, really people working in the health and care delivery sectors would be eligible on an equal footing to each other. We spend a lot of time talking, as we developed our business case, to colleagues in the third sector and the charitable and not-for-profit sector. And you know, we're very aware that it is not always seen it is not always recognised the value they bring to the care pathway. And I think it would be fantastic to have colleagues from those sectors sitting alongside colleagues in health and social care so that they could all understand the value and contribution each part is playing to the care of patients and service users. So the short answer is yes, I very much hope so. The slightly longer answer is it will be dependent on our conversations with government should we get the formal approval, but I very much hope so.
Thank you, Hamish. We'll keep our fingers crossed on that one. And the second question coming in for you now is, would you be happy to discuss BBHC modules in more detail with other universities across the UK who haven't started to look into this yet?
Yeah, absolutely. Our view in Swansea is that nobody has all the knowledge on this, even in the area of my particular focus, which has been about how you apply it in the pharmaceutical and the life science industry, you know, even just that, there is tons that we don't know how to do well, we don't know enough about, and we are working on the research side with other anybody in the value-based healthcare education and research world to share learning, and we should be doing exactly the same in terms of education. So very keen to work, and if that's an offer of a collaboration, please drop me an email and I'd be delighted to talk.
Well, that sounds like an exciting possibility in the offing there, so we'll keep our fingers crossed on that one too. Rebecca, can I come back to you? We were talking about experiential learning just now. I have a question, which is, what's your feeling about the appetite for these educational opportunities on the ground with NHS staff? And do you anticipate that many of the future projects next year will be focusing on COVID recovery, perhaps with a digital element involved?
Appetite is difficult to say, because obviously people are otherwise engaged on some other thing that's going on at the moment. But my sense from the cohort that went before, again, 10 months later down the line, the feedback's been so positive about how it's helped them think through some problem solving on the ground. I would hope that others would be enthused by what they've learned and the experiences they had. And they certainly told me that they would be recommending this as an approach to their colleagues across Wales. So I'd hope that there would be quite a big appetite to do that, especially if we look to expand it to more colleagues in, for example, operational managers as well, so that we get more sort of triumvirates coming along. In terms of, would we expect to see more COVID-related and digital applications? I think it's fair to say that, I might have said this earlier, that those who came this time came with an idea of what value was, but perhaps not really clear about it. And so for some, it really was their first dip of their toe in the water in terms of value. I'd like to think that by the time we launch this again, they'll have a clearer view about the opportunity that applying a value-based approach brings, and therefore will be trying to apply it to very current problems. So as a very long-winded way of answering, I suspect it'd be a mix of both. I think there'll be some COVID-related recovery. Already some people are talking about the use of digital in their organisations more so now than they ever did with patients means we really do need to collect outcomes for patients using this new way of working, and therefore applying a value-based approach is really important. And I'm sure there will be other services that would also like to apply it that isn't necessarily post-COVID recovery. They're more your typical services, I guess. So I'd like to think it's a mix. It's not all one thing or another, but we'll see, won't we, when we put the applications out.
Brilliant. Thank you, Rebecca. And the next question, which I think is one for me, really, in the national programme. At the start, it was mentioned that informal education is just as important as formal. What types of informal education are available, and what are the aims for the future to educate those on the ground collecting outcomes with patients? Great question. So those of us who've been working in this field for the last 4 or 5 years in Wales have been delivering informal education and engagement sessions for all professional groups, and we continue to do that in a bespoke way. So the national programme is always open to requests from clinical networks, professional bodies, and health boards around any work that they're doing that they would like to be supported by the programme. So that's more on the engagement side. And then on the practical implementation education and training side, I suppose it is more, the National Value-Based Healthcare Programme continues to support local teams, and it's particularly effective, I have to say, when health boards have their own local value-based healthcare team with whom we can link in do the work together and spread and scale the training, taking a sort of train the trainer approach, I guess. So thank you for that question. It's really important in terms of translating formal education into practice on the ground, along with experiential programmes like the Clinical Financial Programme.
Sally, could I just add one thing to that, which is,
of course,
is to just absolutely endorse that. And that's why in our MSc and PGDIP, we have a workplace-based project, because that's exactly the same thing. It's taking the formal learning and putting it into practice is the way you really embed that learning and also make a difference. So it's why it's such an important part of our degree program, and I think it just builds on everything you've said as well.
No, thank you, Hamish. It's very helpful, and as you know, and the three of us have had regular conversations around the importance of alignment of the various educational initiatives in Wales and how they make sense within Wales for our healthcare professionals, certainly, but also have that wider application further afield and internationally. Next question is, I think, for Rebecca. There's a question, Rebecca, around the clinical component, the clinical representative on the clinical financial programme appeared to have been fairly heavily medically focused in the first cohort. What's your approach to increasing uptake from nursing and allied health professionals, and how can we boost this in the future?
Great question. It was purposeful, if I'm really honest, at the start, that we'd start with the medics and the medical profession as part of this programme, just to keep it neat and tidy, I suppose, in terms of experience. You know, this was as I said again, a first toe in the water of trying something like this. We didn't really know what we were going into when we started. So we thought we'd work through the medical directors, get their support, run it through that process. I'm quite happy to talk about how we would expand that into other clinical areas. We would obviously need the support of the DOTs and the nurse directors in that approach, if that's the approach we would do to take. I know personally I've been approached by people from non-medical professions really keen to apply value in their service area, so I really think this is a rich area that we could tap into, most certainly.
Thank you, Rebecca. And the session is coming to a close now. So before I do thank our guests today, I'd like to ask for some final comments from Hamish and then Rebecca to close off the session. Hamish, would you like to go first?
Thank you very much, Sally, and Rebecca, and thank you, colleagues, for listening to us. I hope you've been excited by it. We are genuinely very excited about the opportunity to deliver really good education, not just for colleagues in Wales, but as you say, Sally, internationally, because there is a need for that, a real demand for it. And just to emphasise again, and you know, our programme is very open to colleagues from the NHS who are not doctors. We'd love to see some doctors, but we'd love to see some of the other disciplines in health who are sometimes more innovative, if I'm being honest. So we definitely love to see everybody taking part. It all has to tie together. We cannot transform our system in Wales and in other health systems around the world unless people have a really good understanding of it, people are sufficiently informed to lead, we're doing research to understand how to do it better, and we are sharing the learning, and we can do that through cases and so on, and we're certainly looking to develop some COVID related cases to teach on in our programs. So I think we've heard this afternoon just how that is coming together, the combination of informal, of applied experiential, and then formal academic education as well. And I think Wales is going to really put itself on the map, as it has done in delivery in education as well. And it's great to be part of it. So thank you for an opportunity to share.
Thank you, Hamish. And Rebecca, can I turn to you now?
Yeah, I completely endorse everything that Hamish has said. I think we're in a really exciting moment in terms of how we can really explode the education part of value-based healthcare across NHS Wales and beyond. I think we can't have too much of it, really. So there's place for many people to operate in this area, and really quite excited about the prospects of how we sort of develop this much further going forward. So thank you for the opportunity of talking about some of the stuff that we've been doing locally. Thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca. Well, thank you very much, Hamish and Rebecca, for really describing quite an inspirational and exciting programme of formal and informal education coming to Wales in the next 6 to 12 months. We have also got a range of other educational materials on their way via our new website, which is being launched this week through the National Value-Based Healthcare Programme, and a webinar series, which will be a rolling webinar series that Rebecca and I are developing together, that's hosted by the Finance Academy, but will also be accessible through the National Value-Based Healthcare website. Please do keep in touch, and please do look out for the rest of the events still to come in Value in Health Wales Week. Still lots of great content to come. Thank you very, very much for joining us. Diolch yn fawr.